thinking about the world, looking at the nation. Suicide, genocide, homicide. Three words come to mind. Times are changing, yeah. No more rumors, there are wars going on. Twisted doctor, scientists making clones. Economy got some backs against the wall. People dying for no reason at all. People of God don't even read their Bibles. There's no faith, no trust in the word. But everybody seems to be quoting scripture. It's just another word they heard. Pastors leaving pulpits cause they're tired.
Shalom, shalom, shalom everyone. Welcome to the Search Engine International this evening, which is with me, Brother Gaja. Also with me is Elder Rakar. Elder Rakar and Brother Shafat, can you hear me?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, Elder, loud and clear.
Okay, great. And I have Shafat with me tonight. Brother Mark is with us also.
Shalom, shalom.
Hey, blessings, Brother Shafat, how you doing?
Yeah, I'm good, I'm good. How you doing?
I'm good, man, I'm good. I'm excited that you're here, man. I mean, some news on the table then, right? What you have for me?
Some news, some timely news.
Yeah, our UK reporter. All right. You know what I mean? Our UK reporter, not an inside guy like Mr. Watson from
there's no strings on me.
Mr. Watson from Blog Talk. We're not gonna have none of that. But he's our UK connection.
All right, man. Nice, man. Good. Good to hear from both of you, Elder Rakar. I've not spoken to you for a while, man. Good to know you're doing well, Brother Shafat. Likewise, man. And you know, good to know you're all right as well, man. And I keep missing the Academy live. You with me, but. Whenever I go back over it, it's all the news in it is just, on point. You with me? And as usual, the lessons are always there. But you know, the news. I think the news does something different. You understand me? Because it brings that current, what's happening, real time feel to it, man. So keep it up, my brother, man. It's a blessing.
The news bring real time current understanding of what's going on today, and I would like to apologize for our listeners for the last couple of weeks. We're dealing with the holy days, and there was a few situations that was an emergency that we had to forego the radio show for a couple of weeks. But what we're going to do is we're going to put in some substitutes when we can't be on. Therefore, the show will go on every week unimpeded, so going forward. But I thank the Most High. The audience are dedicated. They're with us, and they're always here, even when nothing happens. So we want to make sure that they get something, some level of food, some understanding, some radio connection every Wednesday. So we're going to solve that going forward. For every Wednesday, we're going to make sure. Even we got to plug in my brother, Ramar, or someone that's actually in it during a weekly basis. We're gonna make sure we use one of our other hosts to plug in when you and I can't be here, guys. So I want to tell everyone know that every Wednesday when they plug in, the Blog Talk will be here on Wednesday, the search engine.
Yeah, man, that's a blessing. I get a lot of mails, asking about the show. So yes. Definitely we're going to set it up where a show definitely go on, But
there's two things I wanted to get into real quick. First of all, I wanted to thank all the brothers and sisters of the Hebrew and Bible Academy that we have every Sunday early in the morning for many hours, unlimited hours now. But anyway, it's been a great success, and there's more people that have been enrolled in this academy than any other academy. So I thank the Most High, and the teachings are in depth. So I thank the Most High for bringing forth His Spirit and making it stronger than it has ever been.
Mm-hmm.
That's number one. All praise be to Ahaya Bashim Yeshaya Wawrawak. I wanted to put that out there. And I want to thank the Most High that we opened up another through the Spirit of the Most High and your work, Gaja, and the brothers and sisters who are dedicated there in the United Kingdom. And we've opened up another church in Leeds, UK. Want to give us an update on that?
Yes, Leeds was Leeds this Sabbath gone, and all praises to the Most High for allowing us to, you know, to get there. On the way down there, I got stopped by the police. I've never been stopped by the police since I've been here. We were stopped by the police. It's like something was trying not to let us get there, but we got there. Praise be to the Most High. And you know, the sisters them who organized the building. I want to say thank you to Mrs. Elliot, Claire and Dawada's mother, who she was the one who got the building for us. And we're gonna be there every Sabbath. And for those people who have never seen that video online, GOCC with Rastafari, I think that's the title of the video. A couple of years back, Elder Rakar, when you just came to the UK, you were up there in Leeds talking to the Rastafarian community. And couple of the brothers who were on that video actually came through on on the Sabbath, you with me, and, you know, showed love. So whatever happened back then, you know, the seed was planted, you know. So
absolutely,
you know,
they probably wondered what happened. Where were we?
That's exactly the questions that they were asking, you know. So I mean, it was a blessing, man. We had the sisters brought food. We had a packed out room. The room was packed. You understand me? We had people who were seeing us preach on the streets, who actually came to the gathering. You know, we broke bread. You know, we fellowship, and most I willing, I'll be there again on this coming Sabbath. And it's going to grow. I think Leeds is going to be very big, just like how London took off. Leeds is going to be just as well. So we're just going to keep it going and you know, just keep spreading it, man. So, you know, that's what, you know. And Dawada, Brother Dawada, and Josh, and, all, you know, all of the Bradford brothers and sisters who actually came together and made Leeds what it was. You with me? You know, us from Manchester went down there as well to give support, and it was a really blessed day, man. And a lot of people who came for the first time, who saw it for the first time, heard it, said that this coming Shabbat they'll be there. So
I'll tell you what. When I was in Leeds, it was a great work. I remember going down at least every week. We were doing classes in Leeds on a regular basis. And I'm really sorry that we weren't able to continue there regularly. You know, I'm traveling all over the place and all over the world trying to spread the gospel. But I'll tell you what, in a couple of more weeks, we're going to be in Leeds, and we're going to be right there outside of Dutch Plot, and right near the bus stop, and we're going to bring it again. So I'm going to be there in a couple of weeks. So we're going to help motivate that and bring that forward. And move that work in that area forward, and do other things while we're in the United Kingdom. So today I decided to come through England for a couple of weeks. So I'm going to talk to you after this, and we're going to work it out.
Yeah, man, definitely should be good. Elder, like, you know, as you know, it's always a blessing when you're here. So, you know, like, I know. The last time we didn't get an opportunity to go on the streets. But this time we'll definitely be able to do it, and, you know, head out there. We have a lot of new equipments right now that we have, and you know, we can actually go out there uniformed. The brothers here are uniformed, so it should be a blessing, you know.
Absolutely. So what we have on the plate for tonight? Of course, we haven't been on for a few weeks, so we got to have something interesting going on tonight, and we're gonna of course. There's many interesting guests, and we bless and thank the Most High for them. But, you know, I'm interested in hearing our guest and hearing the news with Brother Shapat, Brother Mark tonight. So what we're going to do is our guest is going to be on for 30 minutes today, and we're going to hear what our guests have to say. Who is our guest? Who's on our plate tonight?
Well, tonight we have a lady by the name of Yonas Lone Wolf. She's apparently the granddaughter of Farrakhan, and she'll be coming on to speak with us for about half an hour. I think, let me just check with Brother Azariah if she's yet in the studio. And if she's not, then Brother Shapat probably could go and bring some news. Let me, okay, she's not here yet. So I don't know if you're right.
Well, I'll tell you what, as Raya have her on standby, what we'll do is
hey, hold up, she's here now.
Sarah?
Yeah, she's here.
Okay, well, let's bring the guest in. We don't want to keep her waiting.
All right, our guest tonight, I think I pressed her name incorrectly before. I said Yanazda. Her name is Yanaja. All right, Yanaja Lone Wolf, and she's here with us tonight. Hello, Ricardo, are you still there? Can you hear me?
Bless you. I am here. I'm here. Yes, sir. Praise be to the Most High.
Praise the Most High. All right, let's go over and speak with Yanaja Lone Wolf. Blessing, sister. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Blessings. How are you?
I'm well. Thank you for waiting and coming on.
Thank you for having me.
All right, welcome to the Search Engine International. As I said before, I'm going to be your host tonight, Brother Gaja. Elder Rakar is here also with us. Elder Rakar?
Peace, blessings.
Yes, sir, blessings. How are you doing, sister?
I am doing fine. Thank you for having me.
Yes. We have a few things to talk about. I know we have limited time today, but we wanted to have you on. Seems like you're having an independent voice that's calling out for you to say a few things. And I know a lot of people probably knew already that this is Minister Louis Farrakhan's granddaughter, actually, right?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. What do you think about being in the shadows of one of the great orators and one of the greatest religious leaders within the United States right now? Let's talk about that first. I'm not going to ignore that. So let's talk about being in those shadows and what has life been for you being Farrakhan's granddaughter, actually?
Well, you know, being his granddaughter has been a blessing. But it also is, I'm already built to fight, to constantly defend the truth when it's being spoken, when those that want to speak lies. So it was, so growing up for me has always been, it's been a blessing because of, I was constantly around the greats of people from Stokely Carmichael to, Khalid Muhammad and a lot of greats that a lot of people now look at, you know, as wow, that, you know, they are wonderful people. But I've seen all of these people bow down in a way or humble themselves in front of my grandfather. But they always was around a round table, but it's been a blessing to be around, you know, him and to see greats like Stokely Carmichael and Dr. Khalid Muhammad and others just kind of be submissive to him, in front of him, you know. And so, and to be around educators and scholars and thinkers and debaters, you know. So, and then I also, too, in school, I was constantly defending him. And so I learned how to defend, you know, someone that I know is the truth. And what he says, and also he also lives the truth. So it's been, you know, I've constantly been already built to fight and to defend.
Okay. So let me ask, he has no problem with you coming into the public spectrum, knowing that all dealing with the controversy and knowing what controversy comes with it.
Oh, no, not at all. As a matter of fact, I have been working for him for the past 10 years, so he has put me in a position to bridge the families, to bring people aware of the universality of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, as well as, you know, the testimonial the testimony of my life, as well as my late mother's life, Juanetta Lone Wolf. And so, no, not at all. As a matter of fact, I was rapping, as a matter of fact. I was rapping and touring all across the nation. And can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you clearly.
Oh, okay, good. So, yeah, I was touring and rapping all across the nation and everything, and I never saw myself helping him in this way in regards to putting on cultural events and mobilizing people for the marches from the Millions Born Movement to even our 20th anniversary of the Million Man March, and then as well as, you know, bringing people aware that we're all connected and to one God, and we're all connected to one another in some way, shape, or form. And so, because, you know, so he has put me in this place of, he has exalted me in this place, I should say. And I thank Allah, and I thank him for it. Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, well, that leads us to the next point of the conversation is a few things we want to talk about. And if we have to go over a little over the 30 minutes, you wouldn't mind, right?
No, not at all. I'm just picking up my son from school, so.
Okay, all right. We're going to try to work with you. We understand you're a busy young lady. We're going to work with you. All right. Let's talk about the, real quick. I really want to go into the heritage of your North American Indian mother on the mother's side in a moment, because we actually did a lesson breaking down the lost tribes of Israel. And come to find out that the North American Indians are actually from the diaspora of the children of God, the children of Israel in the Bible. But what I wanted to speak to you about in passing, because we can't, it'll be a miss if we didn't talk about the march that just happened, what, 10/10/2015.
Yeah.
Right? So let's ask you this. What do you think the community got from the original Million Man March, if you can remember that? What has happened? Did we advance from that? And what was this particular march about that happened this year? Let's talk about the original march and whether or not we have advanced or regressed, or, you know, or what your take, being an inside person within that, being a family member of the Minister Louis Farrakhan, whether or not we have regress or progress since the original Million Man March, and what was this march?
Well, yeah, I would say that the call, both of the calls were different. The Million Man March in 1995 was a call for black men to atone with their brothers. It was such a high amount of violence, black on black violence, and as well as a lot of mothers that was single black mothers. And so the minister called for a million black men to come to the National Mall for atonement. Then after that was the Million Family March. And this is all of the under the guidance of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Of course, a lot of people wanted to duplicate their version of what the minister did. And ever since the Million Man March, we have not seen that one march with a million people, let alone a million black men. So a lot of people did their own million march, you know, different million. I think it was all types of million marches, but never there was a million people in one place since the Million Man March. So after that was the Million Family March, where the minister was like, okay, now that the black men have atoned, many men went back home. They atone with their girlfriends and end up marrying them. They end up atoning with their wives. They end up atoning with their community, atoning with their, and the reduce. There was a huge reduction in violence. There's many statistics that have shown and proved. If you just Google the statistics of what happened, you know, there's a lot of things, the wonderful things that has happened since the Million Man March from that. And President Barack Obama was also a person that championed the Million Man March and attended the Million Man March. So, you know, so there was a lot of positivity that came out of the Million Man March. And then with the Million Family March, the minister married over 200 couples for the Million Family March. And my mother was a part of that. So he married over 200 couples on that morning. And it was to show family It was to show family of all walks of life to come together. Then I was a part of the Millions More movement. The Millions More movement in 2005 was the 10th anniversary of the Million Man March, but it was also where the minister was like, okay, we got some issues happening in our communities. Let's go ahead and develop local organizing committees. Let's go ahead and start linking with various organizations, you know, to start building within the community. So that there was a lot of successful things that happened from the Millions More movement, and now we are on the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March, Justice or Else. This call is different. This call that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan called was, it's time for us to demand justice. We saw so many police brutality cases of murders that was happening. I was a part of, not I was, I am still a part of, on the front line. I was in Ferguson to New York to Atlanta to Arizona. My friend was shot and killed by the police, Romaine Brisbane. My other, my best friend, her 13-year-old son was shot and killed in the head. They shot him in the head in Georgia. So it hit my home. It hit my my circumference of people that I know. So it hit home to me, and I know that it may have, it hit a lot of people. And even if you didn't, I didn't have to know Eric Garner in order for me to be in New York to say I can't breathe. I didn't have to be in Ferguson and know Mike Brown in order for me to say hands up, don't shoot. If you have any feel of knowing the universal pain that was had conflicting on God's children, you wanted to be on the front line. So the minister was like, justice or else. It's a time to demand justice or else, and that's exactly what this call was about. And the feel, now being a part of the executive committee on planning and mobilizing for the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March, the minister really made it clear to all of us. He said, this is just a gathering. We have marched in, we have sang in, we have died in, and nothing seems to have worked. This is a gathering for us to have a meeting of the mind and for us to get together and really come up with some firm demands and to carry them out. And then one of the things is redistribute the pain, the economic blackout, the shutdown of Black Friday, Cyber Monday, you know, all of the things that is coming up where we have such a huge, we use our voice with money. And everyone knows that that many major corporations know that to market to the Black female because we love to shop, to the Latino female because we love to shop, you know, as well as to Black people as a whole. So if we are able to control, like, okay, you know what, we're not going to buy from you. We're not going to spend our money in Walmart anymore. Or we're not going to spend our money in all of these major corporations that are really financing police brutality, you know, so there's a, and as well as a lot of other things, you know, that we are not agreeing on in regards to the current condition of our people. So it's time for us to be able to come together and say, you know, no more. And the only way that Martin Luther King Jr. said is redistribute the pain. This was the direction that he was going towards. Right before they assassinated him, was to be able to say the only way they're going to listen to us is that we stop putting our money in this bank and stop buying this type of bread, you know. And so this was his last address in Memphis, Tennessee, and it's on YouTube for those that are listening to be able to listen to his last speech. But this is where the direction of Martin Luther King Jr. was saying, and this is the direction that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan is saying for us to do as well. And he's not the first, but I believe with his power of being able to make a call, and what we saw last Saturday on 10-10-15, or two Saturdays ago, was is a testament that he still, and he didn't, if you notice, he wasn't on CNN and MSNBC and all of that to promote for 10-10. The only it was social media and blog talk radio shows like yourself, as well as other internet radio shows that help promote help promote it was the only voice. The major media was not trying to touch it. Even in our own black, in our own black media didn't even show it on 1010. And so there was a huge downfall on the BET Hip Hop Awards in regards to people viewing it, because that was their boycott. Like, okay, you didn't show Farrakhan, so we're going to boycott you. So the minister has a huge power to be able to make a, for us to be able to really, for him to say, okay, boycott Black Friday, Cyber Monday, and these major corporations, keep your money, stack your money until they're until they stop killing our people, and until they free our political prisoners, until they, you know, all the different demands that we have, and you could go to justiceorelse.com to look at them. But this is what, so the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March is a different call than it was 20 years ago. And it's a much needed call as it was 20 years ago as well. And the feel was young people. It was 85% of young people that was just like, yes, like we, you know, they was there. They was, you know, they came marching in. They came, you know, they was just, it was fired up, and it was nothing but, and it wasn't just black young youth. It was Latino. It was Native American. And as well, it was white and Asian. It was so beautiful. And I think that for me, just like those that experienced the Million Man March, you know, they said it was the closest thing to heaven. Well, I wasn't able to go to the Million Man March because I'm a woman, and I was a very young girl at the time, and my mother nor my family wanted me to, you know, to put myself in a situation like that. So I stayed home and watched it from television. But, you know, those that went, they said it was the closest thing to heaven. Well, what I experienced on 10-10-15, for me to see the universal family of God that is coming for one cause, which is demanding justice or else, was the closest thing. It was a glimpse of what's to come. We have local organizing committees. You could go on justiceorelse.com, put in your zip code, and go to your local organizing committee and help. And let's help the Honorable Minister of Farrakhan, but most importantly, let's help yourself, you know, in regards to the condition of your community.
Okay, okay.
I hope that was
okay. For our listeners, yeah. We have Yonazda Lone Wolf. I'm pronouncing your name correct, correct?
Yonazha.
Let me make sure we put that right. One moment.
It's okay. I know.
No. One moment.
That language called English can mess up all types of words.
I got you. Yonazha. We have her. Yeah. Yonazha. She's known as Lone Wolf. Yonazha.
Oh, Lone Wolf is my last name.
Okay, Yonazha Lone Wolf, the granddaughter of Minister Louis Farrakhan. For our listeners who have just I see that our listeners are just going up by the second. Real quick, what I would like to do is, I just spoke to you about the Million Man March, but of course I want to talk about you. And I know it's hard. I apologize. I know there's situations where I mean, your grandfather is such a polarized figure that I know it always ends up to some degree in which he comes into the conversation. A matter of fact, his work has given you a level of platform and a voice, so
yeah.
That can't be ignored. Let me say this though. So, what we ask in the quote unquote black community is mm-hmm. that, because we have different opinions, all right? We look at one march to the next, and we look at our situation getting worse.
Mm-hmm.
The people are getting worse, okay? And not only is that, we're noticing, especially in the media, which is quote-unquote Zionist controlled.
Mm-hmm.
We notice a lot of things, and as a matter of fact, we thank the Most High God for things like social media and alternative media and platforms that can actually speak the truth outside of the programming of the Zionist media. We've noticed scenarios like false flag, or what you would call psyops, like the South Carolina Charlotte shooting, which we know it had come to pass to know that people really didn't die in that situation. It was a psyop to cause some level of racial tension. Like the media is promoting and putting forth racial tension. We look at Sandy Hook, which we found out, which was a psyop. We look at all these news they're looking to do, which are psyops, to take drills like what's going on in Ottawa, Canada, like what happened not too long ago, where there was a shooting in so-called Oregon, which these are psyops to take the guns and all that. So when we look at this, we see how the media is spinning racism and all other isms to cause issues. You understand? We see how a lot of activists and others are taking these as hot button points to actually speak to media without telling our people that these things are not actually happening. And I want your opinion on that, how we being psyoped to death. And also, I would like your insight on the fact that a few of our listeners, I've just received a message that with that March 10-10-15, there was a call to the LGBT community, which is, we feel, is an actual slap in the face in circumventing the true civil rights movement, which was established on children, established on those who were children of slaves and dealt with injustice from slavery. Now we look at the LGBT movement, which is really a sexual preference and a sin according to any righteous religious background. How they have circumvented the civil rights movement, how they have actually circumvented and made and really homogenized the true people who have gone through hurt and pain and slavery by our oppressors. And we examine what the LGBT movement is, as if they have been put in place to replace the true victims here. And what's your take on a calling out or reaching out from any community to accept the LGBT perversion?
In regards to Black Lives Matter?
Really, when it comes to our platform, we don't really deal with or care about these little organizations they're putting together, like Black Lives Matter. We don't really care about that, because obviously every other agenda is being put in the forefront. What I wanted to ask you about was, when it comes to LGBT, we've noticed, and someone sent me a message, that there was a reach out before the 10-10-15 March, a reach out from the Nation of Islam to some degree, and maybe you can speak to that and correct that, towards the LGBT agenda, or the LGBT movement. It's like they have a voice or something. Should they have a voice? They're perverted pedophiles and Satanists, and they are a threat to anything we call family. What's your opinion on that?
Because I've been like I said, I've been coast to coast fighting and protesting and community and doing community organizing. On various platforms, and you know, I was on the front line with a lot of strong women. Now, did I ask them if they're sleeping with one another? No. Did I care if they're sleeping with one another? No. Was there a goal that was intended in mind that we needed to do? Yes. And were we accomplishing those goals? Yes. I wasn't. I know that when I was in Atlanta, we did a rally, and you know, there was a guy that came up and he was like, "I'm from the LGBTQ LGBTQT whatever community, and you know, and he was really really promoting his gayness, and it was like, okay, what did that have to do with police brutality that's happening in the state of Georgia? Nothing. But I know that some of the various sectors of organizations, they have been using their sexual preference to be able to kind of put it in a position, like if you want to do gay Black Lives Matter, then promote that and do that. But that has nothing to do with what we're dealing with Black Lives Matter in regards to our skin color being attacked. Black Lives Matter is because we are Black and we are being murdered because we are Black. Not because we are gay Black. Not because we are light-skinned Black. Not because we are, you know what I'm saying? It's Black Lives Matter, period. Now, when I heard that, I heard in Texas that, you know, there was a lot of people that was protesting and fighting for Sandra Bland. And a good friend of mine in Ferguson was telling me that he was like, you know, they're talking about pulling out of protesting for Sandra Bland because her video was just released. And I said, well, what video? Well, she was talking about the LGBTQ community and saying that, you know, why are you trying to make your gayness a part of the agenda when this has nothing to do with it? You know, in regards to when a police is about to shoot you, he ain't asking you, wait, hold up, are you gay? So I could know not, you know, he's not asking you that. You know, he's looking at your skin color. And he didn't ask Mike Brown, was he gay? He didn't even ask Sandra Bland, was she gay? So when she did the video, you know, when she posted this video, and they looked at it like, oh, she attacking Black, you know, Black gays. No, she wasn't. She was saying the straight facts, and the facts is that no one's going to ask you who you're having sex with before they kill you if they're racist. If they're racist, they're looking at your skin color first. So for the minister, that's basically...
Mm-hmm. So what's your opinion, what I'm asking, on this over what we would call exposure of perversion that's being promoted strictly towards our community? But we just wanted to ask you, because we found information that was quite disturbing, that the LBGT had some level of invite amongst the Nation of Islam and this last March. And I want to know, why do we even give them a place? Should they have a place? They are
a secret
to our society.
That's a question to ask the Honorable Ms. Louis Farrakhan, because he was speaking in his own way, but my personal opinion is that, you know, there was people that had a problem that the minister was at, you know, was welcoming gay Black men to the Million Man March. And then, you know,
Hold up now, sister. What is your opinion on that invite?
I don't think there's an issue with that. You know, there's a lot of great... I don't think there's an issue to invite revolutionaries, if whoever they're having sex with should not stop what their cause and what they're fighting for. Now, if they're trying to fight, if they're trying to excel their gayness above Black Lives Matter and really thinking that, oh, a racist is not going to kill them because they're gay or Black, I mean, I believe I already answered the question in regards to the facts at hand when it comes to Black Lives Matter. Those groups that are promoting their gayness over Black Lives Matter, a racist is not going to stop and say, what is your sexual orientation before I kill you? They're just not. They're looking at your skin color, period. And so those that are on the front line, like I said, I was fighting on the front line, getting tear gas and all that, with sisters that may have been gay or may have not been gay. Did that stop me and say, wait, hold up, you're gay.
No.
Do not, you can't fight this cop with me. You know,
I don't think that's the concern of the community right now. The concern of the community is the fact that we understand what that lifestyle does to us internally. It don't have anything to do with it.
Well, let's talk about, in that case, let's talk about the adultery. Let's talk about the molesters, the men that listening to this radio show on the low, molesting their daughters. Judge someone, we gotta judge them all the way across the board. And who are we to judge when Allah and God is the best judger?
Hey, sister, we agreed to that. But the whole deal is, when we're dealing with a movement, and we're talking about the ills of a people that have deteriorated us since captivity, we must address the ills and not invite the ills as a participant within our movement.
I mean, that's what you believe, and if that's a concern with the community, and they felt they didn't want to come to D.C. because the minister keep on extending an invite to the black male on 20 years ago for the million man, I mean, the black gay male, and then now he extended an invite to the LGBTQ, and he also, if anyone has a concern and wants to understand, I would suggest they go ahead and watch the press release of what the press conference of the minister inviting the LGBTQ community.
That's really, even though didn't want to talk about this, that's not the concern. It's one thing to invite them in to correct it. You understand? If you're inviting them and saying, well, here's a platform, we're going to correct you so that you can go back and get right, because spiritually you're not right, so you cannot help us civilly or socially or otherwise. You are a cancer, and you're adding to the destruction amongst people.
Tell me about the other cancers that is already affecting the black community, about men that are committing adultery, and then don't want to, you know what I'm saying? You're like saying, like, oh, no, this is a cancer, but, you know, the molestation and the rape and all of that is not a cancer.
Listen to me clearly. This is what I'm saying. If I'm going to invite a community or a group of adulterers and say, come to the march, and they are a known civil rights movement of adulterers, then I'm going to address that as adulterers. Murderers. I'm trying to give this proper context so that we can get on the same page. If I'm going to invite murderers, known murderers with a group and a civil right to be murderers to the march, then I'm going to address the murder. If I'm going to address another sin or an ill of sodomites and homosexuals and pedophiles who have helped deteriorate our people in an agenda of eugenics, which is known throughout the world, then I'm going to address that point, because they're not just unrepentant.
So do you believe that the minister didn't address it sufficient enough for you or the community that you're saying that is? Because I believe that he addressed it very sufficient. If you go on justicearouse.com, this is what I would like for you and also all the callers to do, is to go to the press conference as he addressed the LGBTQ community. And he also addressed Caitlyn Jenner. So I would love for everyone to hear it from his mouth in regards to him addressing why he extended the invite, as well as him inviting. That was the first time in this tour that he invited the community, as well as, and then he also addressed it again on 10-10-15.
Okay, So you don't agree with the lifestyle of sodomites. That's correct. I'm talking about Europe.
Anyone that is sodomizing anyone, I don't agree with that.
Let me make it clear. You don't agree with two women laying with each other, correct?
What I don't agree with is anyone that I'm not going to sit there in this fight for justice or else and sit there and ask them who they're having sex with. I'm going to answer your question by saying there's a lot of things I do not agree with, period, point blank.
Do you agree with that is what I'm asking?
I don't agree with a lot of things, period, point blank.
Do you agree with women sleeping with each other?
I don't agree with... we can move on to the next question.
Okay, so we'll take that as a yes. Okay? Now, all right.
No, we're going to take it as move on to the next question. Don't put me through some rigging a row of trying to...
People usually don't want to talk about something they agree with. Now, let's go into this speaks to a lot of things right now, but... Let's just go into the next thing. North American Indian. Your grandmother, your mother was a North American Indian.
Full blood, yes, sir.
Okay. Now, let's speak to what the North American Indians have been dealing with as a minority well before, not as a minority, as a majority of North Americans before the conquest, even before they were slaves. Let's speak to that.
What's my opinion on... Your phone is cutting in and out, so you're sounding like a robot in a way.
Okay, I'm sorry. Maybe it's the phone, because I seem to be clear through the radio. It's the radio.
So you said what is...
You're clear now. Go ahead.
Okay. You said that what the North American slave... What did you say? What's the question you're asking me?
Okay. What I was saying is, well before there was slavery, you had the oppression and the destruction of the North American Indians. And I know that your mother have given you history concerning those ills. The plight that the North American Indians have along with the plight of the blacks who have suffered in America. What we found out is through some extensive research, we went into some burial grounds and some information that's being dug up in Ohio, and we realized that the North American Indians were actually from the Lost Tribes of Israel. Did you have any information?
No, I didn't. In regards to them being from the from the tribe of Israel, no, sir.
Yeah, from the tribe of Gad, actually. From the North American Indians are actually from the lost tribes of the House of Israel.
Okay,
so what we're going to do is we're going to make sure Azariah, our producer, continue some of that information, because you have a platform, and I'll tell you, you have a lot of fight in you. I can see that. Maybe you can push some of that and pull some of that together.
Well, no, I've heard that before, but in regards to, we all are connected, and we all have an original place of where we all have derived from, which is Africa. You know, that's not nothing. I think that's very known that we all come from one place, and then we all were separated through travels, through whether exiled, through whatever, which way, shape or form, then we all, as the earth was shifting in X, Y, and Z, then we all, are in the places that we are in now. So I'm not saying that. I've heard that before, but in regards to me adding on to that in a scholar, type of level, I don't have enough information or in regards to adding on to that and how that confirms with the teachings of Native American, you know, teachings, depending on what tribe. Each tribe has its original story of how they came. Each tribe is different. You have the Southwestern tribes, you have the mid, the Plains Indians, you have the Southern, you have the indigenous tribes of South America, the First Nation tribes of Canada, the Caribbean, you know, so they all have their own oral story of how they all came here. So, but in regards to the, what you're, you know, what you're saying in regards to Israel, I've heard that before, but I have not linked it together in my travels with the oral history that is that various tribes have spoken about.
Okay. Just wanted to put that out there because that was an interesting point. And I didn't think it was a coincidence that when we ran into some of your information that's out there, that you were speaking of that Native American heritage on your mother's side. And I didn't think it was a coincidence along the time that you were talking about that. We were actually going into history showing that. Yeah, we were showing that the when Christopher Columbus and the Queen Isabella in the Roman Empire came to the North American shores, they understood, according to scripture, that they were looking for the lost tribes of Israel. And religiously. You know what I mean? So it really blew me away when we found that information, and I'm sure that that could really tie a lot of things into why the Jewish people are attacking us. They understand that if we stake claim to who we are and who the Native Americans are, then the question arises internationally, well, who the hell are they? You know what I mean? And and you know, you have a strong religious background. I mean, and to look at it from a religious angle, having a strong religious background, understanding that even the Arabs looked to destroy the children of Israel in Africa, trying to convert us into different religions. That Islam has a place in our destruction as well as Christianity. You know, and it's deeper than the religion itself. It's who we are as people. They're trying to attack. And I think that we need to bring that to the forefront, that the God's chosen people are being attacked by the religion to stop us from finding our true religion, which are the children of God. You know what I mean? So these are things we really have to bring to the forefront. And what I was looking at, and I thank the Most High for some of this social media, is because when we do get people together and have a large following, the true point of emphasis and attacks are not being brought to the forefront so that we can actually make a true change. I believe that we need to speak the truth for the North American Indians, for the blacks who have been enslaved, and find out who they are and find out what the real attack is. And share our information to bring that to the forefront, because we believe that is the true thing that's being covered throughout all of these events, throughout all these social gatherings, throughout all these things. We are being attacked because they know that we are the children of God.
Right.
North American Indians are the children of God. Mexicans, Cubans,
right.
South Americans, not just Africans. Africa is just a continent. There's a religious belief and a spiritual belief that we have, that we had before falling, that they're trying to disconnect us from. You know what I mean? And I'm sure you coming from a religious background can understand that.
Yeah, well, that as well as coming from a spiritual background. You know, the thing is that there is a huge, the connection, the unification of the black and the red is really something that is feared amongst our common enemy. And the reason for is because of, you know, Master Farad Muhammad in the teachings of the Nation of Islam and the actual facts that has to be studied for student enrollment is what is the population of the original nation in the Western Hemisphere. and that is the 17 million blacks with the 2 million Indians equals the 19 million original people in the Western Hemisphere. Now, those numbers have changed, but what's most important is the with. And so for him to have, that is something that those that are enrolling in the Nation of Islam have to learn and have to know, as well as have to act upon in regards to the bridging. Now, when we go into our own history, we see that the unification of the black and the red, our power, you know, before the slave ships came, well, I believe that there was already Africans that was already here in America. You know, if we look at the Olmec heads that is being discovered, you know, throughout South America and Mexico, and you know, so, but there was already a connection then in regards to the relationship between the black and the red. And then when Columbus and the Spaniards and France and everyone else was coming, they was already turning the Native Americans into slaves. My ancestors knowing the land, went ahead and just, you know, and was running away, and many got killed, many got murdered, but a lot of them was also, you know, running away and knowing the land and knowing how to hide out away from that slave master. Then from there, they was bringing my ancestors, the Africans, to America. And then with the Native Americans that was already here, already went through the treatment, was seeing the same treatment happen again with the Africans, and, you know, and they were helping them. I hate to hear, especially right now, especially after I did the Breakfast Club interview, there is a huge amount of people that is like, well, you know, the Native Americans have slaves. What the hell is she doing? Why is she trying to join the black and the red? And da da da. But see, that is once again, our common enemy trying to teach us the wrong history again. Now, I learned my history, a lot of my history, to be honest with you, through talking to my elders in oral tradition. The stories of my people. I also, you know, I went to school and all of that, and I also went to Morgan State University and studied African and world history and all of that as well. But I also, I ended up leaving Morgan State because I saw my mother in the book. And I was like, okay, my family's in this book. My family is the history. What the heck? I'm having this man teaching me about what I already lived and what my family is. You know, on my father's side, I'm related to Eddie Kendricks and Rosa Parks. On my mother's side, I'm a descendant of Crazy Horse, you know. And then with Minister Farrakhan, you know, adopting me, and that, you know, so I've this history and this thing, I've kind of lived this. But I learned a lot from oral tradition, and in oral tradition, from what I've learned from many of the grandpas and grandmas and elders and everything, what I have learned is that my people, whether I'm Oglala Lakota, but Cherokee, all the nations is my people, and all of the native people did not own slaves per se in regards to, oh, you know, owning slaves and the same type of brutality and everything that the whites did on Africans. It was more so of helping the slaves become free. So the only people that were free and sovereign is the Native Americans. So they was like, okay, let me adopt you, or if I have to buy my husband because I just had a baby with him. If I have to buy my wife because I just had a black and native baby with this woman, if I have to buy my cousin or this in order for this person to be free, let me do that. But it wasn't in the way of them being servants and XYZ. And then that's the reason why we have the five civilized tribes and the Freedmen Association. Okay. And then now today, we are dealing with white or or I should, you know, whites that are saying that they're native, or the $5 Indians, you know, that are that paid $5 in order for them to be Indian, you know, are that okay. were whites are now trying to kick out the black Indians, you know, and things like that. But for many, many, many years, our original people, the black and the red, been unified, and it wasn't that type of they had slaves type of thing happening, you know, like the way that they're trying to promote it now, like, oh, you know, they're really trying to making yourself and myself jobs harder in regards to trying to unify our people. It's not like that. This enemy is wicked in regards to trying to use use history and try to once again reframe it for his own liking. You know,
absolutely. Well, look, we're running into the last 10 minutes before we bring in our callers to ask you a few questions. We have so many callers on right now. So let me just ask you this: since we're going into the last 10 minutes, let me ask you this, just on the religious side of things: are you an acting Muslim at this time, or some people ask, are you a Muslim? You an acting Muslim?
Well, in the words of my grandfather, the Honorable Mr. Louis Farrakhan, I'm a Muslim and I'm also a Christian. I also practice the Red Road, which is the spirituality way of the Native American way. I love God and I believe in one God, and I try my best every single day to adhere to his word and to, you know, and adhere to what he wants us to do, which is treat others how you want to be treated.
Absolutely.
You know, I don't put a religious thing around me, you know, that just divides us. I don't do
okay.
that. I just believe in one God, and I pray to that one God.
Okay, great. So your core religion is Islam, but you respect other religions, I would take it, if you're saying.
No, I go to church. I also go to the mosque, and I also experience, you know, I also go to the sweat lodge. I went to Sundance last July. So it's exactly what I said. It's not what I'm trying to paraphrase. I said what I said.
Okay. So when it comes to just other things like the, you know, in America they got the Black Masonic orders. You don't have no problem with that either, right?
What's the Black Masonic orders?
You know, like the Masons, they have the Eastern Stars, and they have for the women, and they have the different black, different type of Shriners as Masons within the United States. You don't have no issue with that. You think that's okay religiously also?
No, I don't know. No, I didn't say that, and I don't know about the Masons. I've met many Masons, but I don't know.
Like Prince Hall. You heard of Prince Hall. Prince Hall within the United States.
Yes.
So, what is your take on that, like the Prince Hall Mason?
I'm not into Masonry. I mean, I met and I know a couple of Masons.
Okay.
But you know, to each its own. I mean, that's what they do. I don't understand what that has to do with me believing in God.
No, the reason why I'm asking is because in Masonry and the Masons and the Prince Hall belief that you can only become a Mason if you believe one of the three core religions, and you say you agree with them all. Well, I thought I would just ask that because that's the
thing. So is that
thing
your way of trying to figure out if I'm a Mason?
No, I would ask you if you're a Mason. And you can see, we don't shy away from asking you a direct question. What I'm saying is based on your answer, I was saying that that's in the core belief of Prince Hall and Masonry, that they respect all religions. Now, if you want to say you are a Mason, I'm open to hear that too.
No, I'm not a Mason, but
okay.
I do respect all religions that believe in one God. That's
okay.
what I want to say. Yeah,
okay.
I'm not into witchcraft or Wicca or any of that. I believe in those that, you know, that believe in one God and submit to one God.
Okay. Now the last piece because we got 5 minutes before we open up the calls, and I'm going to let you have your say for a minute.
No.
We did some history. On some of the black Jews that ran into Africa. Now, mm-hmm. I just want your opinion on this, all right? Because
mm-hmm.
we love to go back and forth in history because we believe that history is replete. You understand? What goes around comes around, and if we don't know our history, we're doomed to repeat it. And
exactly.
And yeah, I know you can agree with that. In 627, there was a battle of Fos. Where the black Jews were defeated by the armies of the Prophet Muhammad of Islam. 700 of the black Jews were gathered in the marketplace and offered the Quran or the sword. But the black Jews said, we would rather die than to bow to your Quran, and they killed them in Mecca. This is historical. This is actually a historical reference of black Jews that were killed. Our people, before we actually, before we were destroyed, because we didn't want to bow, we refused to bow to Islam or Muhammad, the so-called prophet. I wanted to know, did you ever run into any of this type of history to show that before we had a Christian conquest against us as blacks, that the Arabs did the same thing to us in the old world and killed us for not converting?
Mm-hmm.
You ran into that.
Yeah.
So I read it.
I read it in world history. I mean, when I took world history, I learned about that. It was the crusades of not just only the Christian crusades, but
absolutely.
It was the crusades of the Islamic crusades. Yeah.
Absolutely. So wouldn't it bother one to look at Islam and how it was founded on the blood, sweat, and tears of our people, as well as Christianity, to put them on the same plate and say that both of these religions, outside of the people who are being initiated into it, both of them had a core agenda in destroying our people from its inception?
No, Shaitan had a core agenda. There's always an evil in regards to anything that is next to righteousness. So I'm talking about those that are evil.
Well,
that
Muhammad,
is, you know,
wouldn't you say that Muhammad the prophet was evil for doing this to our people?
No, I wouldn't say that Prophet Muhammad. I have to do my own studying in regards to you saying, you said the black Jews.
The black
and
Jews,
I
yes.
didn't, and then you're saying that Prophet Muhammad called and told these black Jews to go and kill Muslims? Is that
What I'm saying is Muhammad ordered 700 black Jews killed in Mecca for not bowing to the Quran.
Now, I don't know. I never read that. And is that in the Quran? Or is this another teaching?
Sister, that's not in the Quran. That's in his history. You can read that. And let me give you the references so you can get this, okay? From Babylon mm-hmm. to Timbuktu, Satan Angels mm-hmm. Exposed. From Babylon to Timbuktu, Satan Angels Exposed. And there's the Age of Faith of History of the Medieval Civilization.
Mm-hmm.
The Age of Faith, the History of Medieval Civilization. This is the core of how all religions was founded. You're going to find that all religions were founded on destroying the children of God. They created
and who wrote this book?
Huh?
Who wrote the book?
From Babylon to Timbuktu, Rudolf Ard Windsor, which was a professor from Temple University.
Okay.
All right, mm-hmm. that's the key book you would need to have because it has all the references that refer back to the original history and age of religion. Like, we
mm-hmm.
all respect God and understand that God is all in all. He's the omnipotent. He's the greatest. But all in all, we find that these religions, Christianity and Islam, have a core purpose of destroying the children of God, which are black people. And then mm-hmm. we also found out that it was the Roman powers who funded Islam. So they both had a conquest and a mutual interest in destroying us, because the Arabs were from the seed of Ishmael, who had a problem with us receiving the promise from Abraham. The Christians, mm-hmm. the Romans, who are Edomites, had a problem with our people receiving the promise of Abraham. We're the chosen people of God. So they had mm-hmm. to create a religion that would destroy us before our promises would come to full fruition. So I wanted to just put that out there so that, you know, that's one thing I love about social media. It allows us all to connect, share ideas, and look into the ills of the enemy, Satan himself, and the religions he has created. I'm told that right now phone calls won't come in. So hold up one tight. We're going to take a few phone calls, okay?
Okay.
All right, one moment.
All right, everyone, you're listening to the Search Engine International. Just take a quick break. And while Brother Azariah screens some of these calls, we have with us tonight, Yanazaha, Lone Wolf with us. I hope I'm saying that correctly. All right, listen.
Yes, Yanazaha.
Yanazaha, you're listening to the Search Engine International and the Gathering of Christ Church Radio. All right, our guest tonight is Yanazaha Hope. Lone Wolf with us. Yanazaha, I want to say thank you again for being here, staying here. All right.
Thank you.
I'm going to tell you why I'm saying thank you, all right, for staying here. Is that a lot of the times when we do interviews on Blog Talk and people on the phone, but when the conversation is going away, that the interviewer or the person don't like, they usually put the phone down or hang up or come up and you say, you've actually stayed here, and you know, even from it's very obvious that we come from different perspectives, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I want to say bless you. I want to say bless you for that. and it reminded me of a show that we did a show a few months ago with Dr. Umar Johnson. Are you familiar?
Yes, I know him very well.
Yeah, and we also had another show with a show called The Irritated Genie. Are you familiar with him?
Well, what's the name again?
The Irritated Genie.
Irritating Genie?
The Irritated Genie, yes.
No, uh-uh.
Well, he's, you know, he's like Umar Johnson, part of the Pan-African movement, right?
Mm-hmm.
No. The question, before I open the lines, I want to ask you a question based on what I've heard you say. And it was a question that we had actually asked Umar Johnson, and we also asked it to Irritated Genie, all right? But what I'm gonna do here first, I'm gonna read from the Bible first, and then I'm gonna ask my question, all right?
Mm-hmm.
It says, and I'm in the book of Matthew, the 12th chapter. You say you're Christian, so you're familiar with the Bible, right?
Yes,
All right. So I'm in the book of Matthew, the 12th chapter, and I'm at the 25th verse. And it reads, and Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And why I went here, just to the question I wanted to ask, right?
Uh-huh.
If we look around, right, and we are the same people, right?
Uh-huh.
But we are divided based on our, you know, on our religious rites or religious practices, right?
Uh-huh.
And our belief, our core belief, even just based on morality, what is moral and what is immoral, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I take it one step further. Like for me, I'm in the UK, and if mm-hmm. I like five or six black men in a line, and I ask them what's their you know, nationality, normally I get five different answers. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, like I'm saying, even like going to things though, like morality, basic morality, like we spoke a lot tonight about sodomites and all of that stuff. I mean, how do you see a group of people coming together, right?
Mm-hmm.
When we are so divided, even, you know, what laws would govern us coming together? Because, for example, you said here before that, you know, you're Christian, you're Muslim, you know, you practice the native Indian spirituality, and from where I'm standing, that's three separate religious thought process. You understand me? When you look at Christianity or dealing with a Christian, there's things that a Christian would do that a Muslim wouldn't do, or and things that Muslims do that people who are of the Bible persuasion shouldn't do. You follow me? I give you a very simple example within it. When it comes to, say, dietary laws within Islam and what the Bible prescribes for us to do, there's a big chasm right there. I mean the Muslims will say that, well, we don't eat pork, but shrimp, crab and lobster and camel is okay. But according to the Bible, that's wrong. And that's just one aspect of it. You follow me? Now, sodomy. You understand me? The Bible has a clear definition on sodomy. When, you know, there's other groups out there that don't think that there's anything wrong with that. You know, so how do you see, just give me your understanding on how do you get all of these people working together when all of these people are the same people? And, you know, what should govern them?
You know, I'm going to say this, that the minister asked the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, what is the best religion? And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that the best religion is do unto others as you want done unto yourself. There is no religion that is better than the other. You know, as long as you are doing right, if you are striving your best to live in righteousness. Now, a lot of people, a lot of, you know, we was talking about Native Americans. And the thing is that, you know, especially a lot of, I'm going to say so-called Christian crusaders of today, they go into indigenous communities and they're like, you know, well, you're not going to be saved. You're not going to go to heaven if you do not bow down and submit yourself to Jesus Christ. You got to be a Christian or you are not going to go to heaven. And, you know, all of these types, that is a modern day crusade. There is actually no religion that is better than the other, nor, and it's already in many indigenous nations of doing. You want me to finish?
No, hold on. I want to stop you here, right? Sorry. I mean, no, the Bible says don't interrupt a man in the midst of his speech. But why I'm stopping you here is because what you're answering is not really the question I'm asking. You follow me? So I never wanted you to finish and then me ask the question again. That's not really what I'm asking. What's even better? I'm saying that we all here are the same people experiencing the same problems. Like you said earlier, is that when the enemy comes to pull the trigger, the enemy not asking you your sexual preference, or
right.
You understand this? So I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about us as a people, right?
Mm-hmm.
What will govern us internally? Because, okay, like
it's already, it's all, okay, we want to get biblical. God said he knows, my children know my voice. We already have a spirit of discernment within us of what's good and what's righteous and what's not. So that's what governs us. You have a deep down, you could tell a child. A child would know if they're doing right or doing wrong, unless they get taught otherwise.
Well, watch me. So Hey, guys, I
think the point, I understand what the sister's saying to some degree. I think that what's being amiss here is that the principle she was speaking of, well, you're on the phone, sister, so I'm speaking to you. The principles that you're speaking of were Christ's principles speaking to a people called the children of Israel in the Bible. The children of Israel in the Bible had a law that they were governed by. So they understood right from wrong based on those principles. They weren't Muslim. They weren't Buddhist. They weren't Christians. They were called Christians by the Roman Empire to identify them. They were a people. So I think that what we can take from this is, as long as we have this ambiguous term on what God wants us to do, we will always be in the same condition. Instead of dealing with laws that governed us from the beginning and coming back to our core principles, that's the only answer, or we'll always be in this condition. We'll stay here, because a homosexual or a pedophile or people that do ill have their own interpretation of loving each other like they love themselves. And there'll be no judgment on them as a society because we are allowing it to happen. We don't have a core principle of what we should follow as a people, and that's our core ill. That was part of our demise and led to our captivity. And I think that's the piece that God was trying to bring here to you, sister, is that the Most High God is not due to interpretation or how one feels they should worship him. He has rules. And Islam, Christianity, and all the religions that are part of our captivity have diverted us from those true rules. Instead of us looking at the Bible and seeing what God says, we've listened to man's interpretation. And through that, we're living as a people through interpretation and are divided. Of course you can see that. Is she with us?
Yeah, I'm here.
Of course you can see that. Like, a lesbian who's a lesbian, they'll look at the Bible and see that it's incorrect and say, well, listen, I don't deal with that part of it. I'm just loving people as I love myself. But yet, what they're doing is destroying our society internally while we are allowing them because they claim they love God. Same thing with a murderer. The same thing with a sodomite, the same thing with everything that's destroying our people. We are enablers as a people, and we don't want to admit it. We are enablers because we don't want rules, and that's what's destroying our people. And it have went up to the highest level, even up into religious powers, and people are controlling things, and people that has a voice have now compromised. Somebody has to stand for something as a people, or we're going to continue to be destroyed. We can't leave this open to interpretation based on someone being educated or someone having a high position. What do God say? And are we going to follow what God say? It's really the end of all of this. What do God say? Not whether or not we love people like we claim that we should love people. What do God say? Do God say we should love a homosexual that's unrepentant in destroying our people? Do God say we should love a killer or a murderer or a pedophile? Do God say that? Do God say that we should shake hands and not ask questions concerning someone socially and morally destroying our people? Don't ask questions, and just because we have a common ground, we can still walk with them. Do God say that? There is no common ground for immorality and the destruction of a people. And I think that's the message to be out there, that we are a people that have left God. We have left the Most High, and we've interpreted him. We interpreted what we feel he should be. And that's why we are destroyed people. And we can't come together because we're using religion as a scapegoat to do our own will. We choose Christianity because we feel it fits us, or Islam because we feel it fits us, or Pan-Africa because we feel it fits us. And no one is asking God. No one is looking into that Bible or looking at the laws and saying, this is where we went wrong. We went wrong by not following his laws, and they are not compromised. We're not going to compromise with a sodomite. I don't care if you agree with being black with me. If you're a homosexual, the Bible says it's enough grace right here that you're breathing. Okay? Leviticus 20 and 13 say you're supposed to be dead already. Okay? So what you need to do is repent, then come be black with me. You can't march with me. You can't stand with me. The same thing with a liar, a thief, a killer, someone that's following other religions that's destroyed our people. That's where we need to be. We need to have a common place where we can say this is what God say and stand for it. Or we'll always destroy the people.
We'll always for your radio show. You have a platform that you just talk about.
Absolutely. You know, let me get off my soapbox. Speak to the sister. Mm-hmm. Come on. Come on in, people.
All right. All right, everyone. You listen to the search engine. All right. We're gonna take some callers, all right? Yanaja, you okay for that? Yanaja, you there? She there?
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, she's here,
Gaja.
Oh, okay.
You know, I'm going to open up for some comments, all right? Questions and comments. So let's go to the first caller. We have Jeff with a question and a comment. Shalom, Jeff. You're live.
Yeah, shalom.
Shalom, you Jeff. You got speak up for me, please. You're a bit low.
Yeah, how are you doing? Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead. I can hear you. Go ahead.
Yeah, I got a question for Elder Ricard, please.
Okay.
A scriptural question
for Elder Ricard. Elder Ricard,
yes,
go ahead.
For my Elder Ricard, how are you doing, man? It's Jeff, bro. Hear me?
I'm doing fine. I'm on a radio show. Talk to me.
Yeah, can we get Matthew 13 and 33, please?
Okay, Matthew 13 and 33. Okay, Matthew 13 and 33 says, another parable spake unto them. The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal till the whole was leavened.
Yeah, what does that mean, please? What does that mean?
Well, it says the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven. When you look at leaven, leaven is a small amount that affects the whole. You may put a little bit into a mix of bread and whatever, or flour and water, and it will make the whole grow. You have a whole loaf of bread off of a little leaven. So it's like a woman, which Israel is the woman, who hid treasures and meal till it all came to full fruition, till it all grew. So you may put a little bit in, but you will receive great. You understand? If you put in.
Okay, well, on that note, can I speak to you after the show, if you don't mind, if you got a little bit of time?
I beg your pardon?
I said, can I speak to you after the show, if you got a little bit of time?
Well, I have a meeting after this, but I can speak to you tomorrow.
Yeah, that's no problem. Just make sure.
I'll call you tomorrow. That's no problem.
Yeah. All right, no problem.
All right.
And as for this, can I have one question for the sister, please?
A question for the the guest?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. My question to you is, as far as Islam, what, we know that it has a hand in our slavery, right? So why is Mr. Farrakhan identifying with the Quran, but every other scripture you pull is a biblical scripture. I just need understanding on that, if you don't mind.
You said that it's so hard to hear you. Am I the only person that is going in and out, or?
No, it seems like
Farrakhan, he identifies with the Quran, but
yeah.
Every scripture he pulls is a biblical King James scripture. I don't understand that. Can you explain that to me?
Every time he speaks, he has the Quran and he has the Bible. Because, like I said earlier, you know, if you really understand, like what the minister said, he said that every good Christian's a good Muslim, every good Muslim's a good Christian. And because so many people that comes to listen to him are Christian. So he's speaking the language of the people, and as well as if you go to the interview that he did with Pastor Jamal Bryant on Daystar, on the Daystar Network, he was speaking to the Christian community. So he knows the Bible very well, and then if you've ever picked up a Quran, you know that you reference back to the Bible and vice versa. You know, you cannot read one without reading the other. And so even as he is a minister, he preaches the word from both the Quran as well as from the Bible.
All right, that answers your question, Jeff. Let's take the next caller. Brother Jeff, could you just push one, please, and that will take you out the queue. All right, I'm going to go to the 3-5 area. We have Akawa here with a comment and a question.
Shalom. Shalom, Elder Bakar, Elder Gaja, and Sister Yah. We really appreciate you coming on. I'm going to be honest with you. I feel like Gaja feel. A lot of people would have tapped out. You didn't tap out. You hung in there, sis. We appreciate that. We honor you for that, straight up. But growing up in Newark, right, in New Jersey, mm-hmm. back from, you know, going as a youth, your grandfather came to Newark, and me, you know, my father's a preacher. I wasn't really feeling the church. I knew something was missing. And Farrakhan came, you know, brothers, everybody gathered, and we really liked him as an orator. But still, mm-hmm. there was something missing. It was like people trying to keep a secret. Like, something was missing, you know what I mean? And that's what I felt. And a lot of other people felt that. Come to find out, we are the children of Israel. You understand? That was the part that's been missing. You got this Pope overseas, you know, coming over here, everybody worshiping him, all the nations and the children of Israel worshiping him, when the scriptures tell us to call the bow down to no man. Call no man your teacher in that respect. And mm-hmm. what really got me, and I'm glad you're on the phone, when you get a chance, just say, you know what, one of the brothers from North asked me to ask you, are we the descendants of the children of Israel? And if so, why you ain't bringing that out?
This is what I would love for you to do. I would love for you to go on finalcall.com, and there is a speech that the minister spoke about called the children of Israel.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
All right. And last thing, I wanted to hit, like, I know, you know, I deal with the Bible a little bit.
One sec, Brother Aqua. Just making this announcement real quick. We are live on Ustream on the church's channel. So just go over there. Those of you listening or get caught up in the overtime, just go to Ustream. And we are streaming live right now, okay? Go ahead, Aqua. You got 30 seconds.
All right, real quick. So, like, check it out, right? In Revelation chapter 2, verse 9, right? It says, I know your works. And I'm saying that to you, sister. It seems like you got some works, right? But if you go mm-hmm. down a little bit more, right? It says, mm-hmm. and I also know the blasphemy of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan.
Yes.
You ever heard that scripture?
Oh, of course, and the minister spoke about that too. So let me just give you actual facts. It's who are the real children of Israel. It's a part one, part two, and part three lecture
That was June 24th on 2010, Atlanta Civic Center. So do go and look at the ministers speaking on that, as well as the synagogue of Satan.
All right, and my last thing, I just want to say, sister, you and I, we are the children of Israel. And our God, when you say, you know, like you deal with, like, there's responsibilities that the children of Israel have. And there's a scripture, maybe God's going to bring it out, where it says that there's certain nations that would try to wipe us out from ever knowing who we ever was, so that we will all never know who we are. But guess what? We know who we are now. And I'm going to let the next caller call. Shalom, sister. Keep it going. Peace.
All right. Peace.
All right, Aqua. Thank you for that. Just push one from the brother that will take you out of the queue. All right. And just to remind you again, everyone, we are into the overtime right now. So if you do get disconnected, please go over to the Ustream and you'll be able to listen to us live.
Okay.
Let us go over to the next caller at the on the 502 area code. And the scripture the brother was referring to just then was Psalms 83. All right. Let's go to the 502 area code, Sister Shadala, with a statement. All right, let's go. Shalom, sister.
Yes, hello. Shalom, everyone. I just have to say this to the sister. How are you doing?
Peace, how are you?
Shalom, how are you? I don't have the scripture, but the Bible does say that you cannot add to or mesh the Bible with another book. So when you say you do the Quran and the Bible vice versa,
where does
that's
it say that
statement.
At? Where does it say that at? And it also, too, we also have to keep in mind how many times and how many various versions of both of these holy books are. You know,
I'm referring to the King James Version, sister. That's it. That's it.
Okay,
and if either of the elders can help me out, I know the Bible says you cannot add to or mesh the Bible with any other book.
Well,
and that's scripture.
Okay. Well, I don't know if I'm not going to be rich or on what is the intent of this radio show? Is it to get more people to become Christians? What's the purpose of the radio show?
Absolutely not. The purpose of this radio show is to put the truth out there according to the Bible. That's the purpose of this radio show, according to the King James Version Bible.
Sister, Shadala, one sec. Let me just put you back in queue, all right? And I'll read.
Okay.
I'll read that you're referring to.
You asked me to be on this radio show, but it's sounding to me that this is a radio show, which I have no problem. Don't get me wrong. I don't have a problem. But if you're looking for a religious type of leader to be able to speak to everyone biblically and all of that, I could refer you all to someone that would love to go into healthy debates in regards to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam and Christianity. Now, if you was asking me to come on your radio show to talk about myself being Native American and Black, what I know in regards to that, then I have no problem. But if this is a radio show
let me just come in real quick. I'm sorry. Let me just apologize. We are a Bible-based radio show. And in dealing with the Bible, we are not, you know, we are not affiliated with the Christian church. We are actually we are the children of Israel according to the Bible. So this is why the nature of the queens are coming along in this fashion. So we're not here looking to get members of the Christian church, but we do read the Bible, we do believe in the Bible, and we do identify ourselves as the people of the Bible. So this is why the nature of the questions are coming the way they are. I'm sorry,
if we want to get into scripture and all of that, and you would like a representative of the Nation of Islam or the Honorable Minister of Farrakhan to get in a discussion like this, I could refer you to someone on a scholastic type of level to go into these type of discussions with you all.
Well, sister, to be told, truth be told, you coming onto the show tonight was needed to talk about the Native Indians, truth be told. You understand? No, we couldn't have you on and not mention the fact that you are the minister's grandson. You have to just get, you know, and I think that's where the whole discussion came from. Really, we want to bring some edification coming out that the Native American people or the Native Indian people are actually the children of Israel who were scattered from 721 BC, who actually came over into the Americas. And there's a part in history, and I'm gonna get Brother Arthur Wright to send it over for you, all the references as well. Even when Christopher Columbus was making his journey over, actually using our records to go and find our people to destroy them.
As you know,
when they came over, when they went into Mexico, there was over 23 million Native Indians there in a civilized community that they utterly wiped out. When they went over in Hispaniola or the Dominican Republic, they utterly annihilated the people down there, bringing down the population there to less than a million. That's really what we want to talk about, going into the teaching of Islam, because I know you are capable of answering some of the questions from a scholastic point of view. You follow me? Let me bring Elder Rakari in. Elder Rakari, you there?
Okay. Thank you.
Sister, really, we have a regular following on the radio show, so... No, I can't apologize, but we don't screen the call, so we don't know who's going to ask what. Let me ask you this, okay? Because, of course, there are situations where we're invited on certain shows and things go another way. Some of the things that you said based on Black Lives Matter, when you're going into that, I think it swung the conversation into where we, into a more interesting conversation. But anyway, let me ask you this. According to anything, just you as a person, someone that's actually coming into the spotlight on their own, you feel that you have an obligation to our people out. You understand? And I know you understand.
Your phone is cutting in and out. I'm so trying to hear you. All I heard was something. I don't know.
Okay. Okay. Uh-huh. Can you hear me? Can you hear me clearly?
Yes. I can hear you.
All right. This is what I'm saying, sister. You are coming into the public spotlight right now. And understanding that there's a lot that comes in. Right? And through that
I'm coming into a public spotlight.
Yes, sister. By you bringing forth who you are, what your objectives are, and you are helping. You are a person that's working the public to help empower and help our people overcome the ills that we've dealt with. That's the spotlight you're stepping into. You understand that?
Oh, I've been in this spotlight for a minute now, so it's not...
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is, based on that, sister, when you have a voice, it can do many things. It can lead someone in the right direction, or even if ignorantly... So it can actually work in the reverse. Any leader. So I'm not trying to interpret anything. What I would like you to do is to state what your purpose is. What do you hope to accomplish? Because the information we brought forth tonight was things that we thought that can help empower you to do what you're doing.
No, I mean, but I love what you all are doing. More power to what you all are doing. But it's one thing
to push your agenda on someone you're interviewing, or you're pushing what you know and your teachings on what you know, and like, this is what you're going to say, So it's one thing to do that, and it's one thing to educate. If you want to educate me, then we could get off the radio show, and I could take some time out of my day, and you could send me all the wonderful things you want to send me and say, and to show me and teach me and everything like that. And if I happen to receive it and as it being truth, then, then it is what it is. But you asked me to be on a radio show because I believe you hit me up and said that you saw the interview on The Breakfast Club. And so you asked me to be on this radio show, and I don't mind building, with you all and everything, but in regards to trying to use, an agenda to, for me to say what you would like me to say, because you're like, oh, she has a voice and now she could push more of our agenda to people, then that's not right.
We're not saying that. We're asking you to tell us, what do you hope to accomplish with your platform? I don't want you to push our agenda. Because it seems like you are interpreting what we're saying. And that's not so. You mean all the great minds that you run into with information that have helped you develop you to what you are today. What we're saying is, I have no idea what we're going to talk about when you were on the radio. We do this radio show in the spirit. Whatever the spirit takes us is where we go. We didn't say, well, this is what we're going to talk about when you come on. There was no plan. We don't have any ledges or sheets or a program, or an editor, or a producer in our ear telling them what to say. But when the opportunity presents itself, we feel a need to share so that you can share. We don't want you to push anything. So I need to know, what is your agenda? What is your question? What do you hope to do for our people?
I hope that that I'm able to bridge communities, nations, of together for a better way of living. And that's really my purpose, is to be able to bridge communities and nations in righteousness together. In one aim, one goal, one God, and in one form to be able to do that. Whether it's through music, whether it's through whatever platform in it for freedom, justice, and equality, I pray that is able to happen. I believe that like I was talking about Black Wall Street, When we hear about Black Wall Street, we hear of a community of original people that was thriving and everything, and the jealousy was so real that the white man ended up burning it all down, because it was people that was actually really being sufficient and doing for self. And then I'm like, wow, that sounds beautiful. I have a friend that lives in Jerusalem, and she is an Israelite, and she always invites me out to Jerusalem. And the community that she's a part of, she told me that where she lives, they respect the Muslims, and they respect the Christians, and they respect the Jews. At certain times of the day, they know, the Christians and the Jews know, that the Muslims are about to say prayer. So basically everything just shuts down. Now, this is according to her. I've never been to Jerusalem to see this for myself, but she was telling me that it's like the closest thing to how God would love us for us to live in. And I was like, wow, just how amazing that is. You know, her backyard is the Red Sea, and she, you know, and they have a community of people that are all connected together, and, you know, and it's just beautiful to hear that, you know. And I just think that I would love to be a part of developing a community or a nation like that here in America by whatever needs to happen, you know. To know
that. Sister, real quick. You read the Bible, right?
Yes.
Do you know that the joining of all religions started with Nimrod, with Satanists? And
you
the reason I'm putting this out
joining
is
a Satanist? What'd you say?
Listen, do you know the joining of all religions under one God, believing the same thing, different beliefs, was under Satan? So even though you're saying that's beautiful, it's satanic. You cannot.
So you think that? Do you think that? You know what? I really can't with where you're going with this conversation. You're saying that it's satanic for Jews and Christians and Muslims to live together in peace?
Absolutely. There's no peace for that. Because
okay.
If they were all following
so
the real...
What other questions would you like to have for me? Because I'm not going to go into this conversation.
Let me explain something to you. If they were all under one God, then they wouldn't be...
Do you have any more callers, sir?
Yes. So what you're trying to do, sister, is satanic. Let me put
that
out.
What I'm trying to do is that you have your opinion, and I'm not going to go into... I just voiced my opinion. You gave me a platform to answer my opinion, and I'm not going to go into a debate with you on the radio.
All right. We got a few more callers. We got 5 minutes for the show, and then I'm going to wish you guys speak. That's a
now I see why people be hanging up.
Yeah. Hey, you win it now. You win it. We tell it like it is.
No, so what y'all do is you're like, forget what you're saying.
Yes, stay kind. What's the next one here?
We go to the next caller here. We have from the 22nd here. All right. Hello? Caller from the 252 area code, are you there? Okay, no answer there. Let me go to the next one. Caller from the 401 area, you are live.
Yes, I'm here. Hello?
Hey, gosh. Hello?
Yes. 401?
401. Go ahead. You're live.
Yes, I'm here. Shalom, and assalamu alaikum to the sisters on Talk Show. Am I on?
Well, alaikum salam.
Hi. I'm calling because I was a Muslim from the age of 14 to I turned 37. And I just wanted to share my testimony with you, if you don't mind.
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. All right. So I became a Muslim when I was 14. Actually, I had my 43X, and I was under the Nation of Islam. I went to Claire Muhammad. And what happened to me, I was first a Christian. And from becoming a Christian and then going into Islam, it was kind of different. But from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, at that time, it was more like a fad, because it was in the early 70s. No, not the early 70s, mid-70s. And I felt when I first took my Shahada, I took it and really didn't understand what I was doing. So while he was telling me to repeat the Shahada, I was saying the Lord's Prayer. And, it was a fad, so everything went quite well when I was in Philadelphia. But when I moved out of Philadelphia, away from the black Muslims, and became more like an Orthodox Muslim, I seen people from other nations and other tongues, and it became now not like a fad, but a religion. And I remember talking to the Iman, and the Iman told me that, okay, you need to take your Shahada again. I said, okay. And that night I went to sleep, and I had a dream in my sleep, and it was a man in my sleep, and he looked at me, he said, I'm going to prove to you that this is not the right religion. And that day I woke up, I had a terrible headache, but I went through it anyway. I went to the mosque, and I took my shahada. And at that point, I felt more further away from the Most High than I ever did in my life, and I couldn't understand why. And I kept just juggling with, what's going on, what's going on? Why do I feel so far away from the Most High? And so finally, make a long story short, I just couldn't do it any longer. I said, you know what, I have to go back to Christianity. And then I went back to Christianity. Of course, I found out that they lied to me. And I now, you know, into the Hebrew Israelite, find out that I am actually the real people of the Bible, which makes more sense to me. And I'm not saying that you got to switch like that or change, but I do know that what I'm doing now is the right thing. And I just want to share my testimony with you.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. And I'm thankful that you are able to find God in any way, shape, or form. However you found him, you found him. Because a lot of people walk this earth, don't even find him or know his voice, period. And however you find him, that's the way. So thank you for sharing that.
All right. Thank you. Assalamualaikum. And shalom.
Wa alaikum salam.
All right, bless you. We're coming into the last we give the sister the final say. Yanash, the granddaughter of the minister. You have the last set.
Yanash.
Yeah, the phone is echoing or something's going on, but it's just the end of the show, because I can't, it's just a lot of chaos at the
bottom here. 1 second. All right, go ahead now. Sister, go ahead. Still get echo on my side. Okay, she dropped. Alright, hold on. Alright, that's much better. I was getting an echo there. Ella Rica, are you there? Can you hear us?
I'm here. Was the echo coming from her phone?
Actually, no. It was coming from another open line. I just saw it just then.
What open line?
There was from the last caller.
There was another caller that was... Okay. All right. Well, I'll tell you what. All praises be to the Most High. We was up in time when it came to the interview anyway. But I just thank the Most High that we had an opportunity to share, you understand? In a way, it was great. And another way, it was to some degree disheartening, because it seems that our people really have the means to want to do right and do the right thing. But the direction in which way to go is really distorted. That's the distorted part, the direction and how we come to. We say we want to come to a mutual consensus on achieving what's right for our people. We all say that, but we want to exclude the content of the Bible and wonder why our people are continually going backward. You understand? And it shows something also. If I were to go out there and just give my opinion on something without a background and a core belief in a God, the world would receive me. And it's a shame. And yes, we went to some of the Native American background of her mother and what have you. It was the original intent on the radio show, but when she started going into her activism and what she was looking to do, that became a more interesting hot-button topic that I thought that we should discuss. You understand? We need to discuss how we are allowing homosexuals and people that are against God into our community for embetterment, claiming that we're looking for social justice and looking to better ourselves as a people, but we're inviting the very ills that are destroying us within the movement itself. We should discuss that. You understand?
So Ella, why didn't they just invite the drug dealers to come as well?
Yeah.
You know, the murderers.
The pedophiles. Why not just let the whole, you know, let's just open up the whole line. And I'm starting to look at it. It's more so about a political influence on a voluminous or volume of people and who they can influence with whatever they're bringing forth. Been improving our case as a people. It's starting to seem as if these marches is for volume. The number of people they could influence to follow.
Mm-hmm.
It's really not for a cure to our ills. Because when you look at it, if they cured our ills, would there be a march? Mm-hmm. If there was no issue, why would a march be needed? So I'm starting to believe that these marches are a product to see how many people are still under the program, are still being destroyed and not understanding that they're so way out. Anybody that go to these marches, anyone that goes to these marches, is a public showing of how many people are still programmed and controlled. Obviously. You understand? And like, respect to her, obviously she didn't have no historical background. I understand that. But still, she thrusted herself into a public spotlight, and with that comes scrutiny and the questions concerning credibility on whether or not you're really ready to deal with being a public activist, because these are the things you're going to deal with. You understand? People are going to want to know, what is your agenda? What are you trying to do? Are you just another one of the people that are now gaining a platform, finances and otherwise, off of the ills of our people without a clear-cut answer, without showing our people the way out?
Mm-hmm.
So, hey, that's what this radio show is for. Hey, we don't have no producers. A matter of fact, when Azariah and Gaja told me that who was going to go on, we didn't know which way the radio show was going to go. We said, well, okay, well, let's see where it takes us. And we go wherever the spirit goes. And if it aligns us in bringing forth some information that can help people who claim they're looking to help our people, then you take the resources and grow with it, mm-hmm, and help our people with it. It shouldn't be an attack on someone if we are giving them information to quote unquote help our people. If that's what they're really trying to do. Now, if you're trying to join all religions together like that Satan is over there in Israel she's talking about, then we're going to call it like, we're going to call a spade a spade. Okay? What religions are you joining together in Israel while the children of Israel are suffering in Babylon and all over the earth being destroyed, while they're planning a worldwide destruction called Jacob's Trouble? How are you trying to unite all people in America like someone is doing in your homeland? And you don't even know that's your homeland. What type of backwards thinking is that?
Mm-hmm.
So we have to call it like it is. How is it? You can tell that when people haven't been anywhere, too. You can tell she hasn't been in Israel. How can you call that peace? She go to the airport in Israel, they're going to treat her like dirt before she can get to the other side. So you can't even say well, there's somebody to have a community that respects our religion. She hasn't been there. That's a facade. That don't exist in Israel. Okay? That don't exist. That's a facade you can only sell to a captive people that are being controlled through media in America. That's a facade. There's no peace. Mm-hmm. When the Palestinians are being killed greatly in number as we speak, while the Syrians are being killed greatly in number as we speak, she wants somebody trying to unite a community where all three religions respect each other. But, I mean, what type of programming is going on in America to have you believe something like that? That exists in Israel, in a stolen land that's about to be destroyed by Iran, according to scripture. So I didn't go in. I believe it or not, I really took kid gloves with this thing here, in respect of bringing her on as a guest. You understand? So I'm making clear. I was very respectful and in respect to a guest on this show today, because I've heard nothing but madness. You can't say you come from Islam and go to Christianity and go to saying you're dealing with all this religion. That, you know, that's infiltration at its greatest. I don't want somebody to be something else coming amongst me and think that it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
What type of thing? To me, I mean, if you believe all things and you come in amongst me, you are an enemy. You are a agent.
Mm-hmm.
You don't really believe what I believe. Why are you here? What are mm-hmm. you doing here? So these are the things that need to be examined. And Christians have to realize how they've been infiltrated on this love trip they're on, and accepting anybody and anything amongst them, and how they're being infiltrated to the point where Farrakhan is infiltrating them now. He has infiltrated them. Why? Because he sees the Muslim community drying up. And there's a wealth of people that he can utilize as far as resources within the Christian community. Anybody mm-hmm. following that Islam stuff no more. So now you hear more Christianity now and more Christ and more of the Bible than anything. This is a political ploy. It don't have nothing to do with raising our people and bringing our people together. It's a compromise. If you believe that Christianity was the way, then you would have been a Christian, not a Muslim. Then. Ain't no, well, I'm going to be all things to all people I communicate to get with them. That's total rubbish. There's a reason why you didn't choose Christianity. Bring that out so that Christians will know whether or not to follow you, because that's your core belief. You are against Christians. Muslims are against Christians, or they would not have been Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
Bring that out. Talk about that. Talk about what, not don't talk about what we can agree on. Let's start with what we disagree with, so I'll know whether or not I want to listen to you going first. Let all people. And you got a Satan right next to you, but he agree. He love his kids the way he love his kids and want to protect his kids. And you love your kids and want to protect your kids. So y'all have that in common, so we can sit down together. But he love his kids differently. In about 3 months, his kid going to be in a six-pointed star with fire around it. With that child being sacrificed. But that's his interpretation of love. And we supposed to sit down and be like, yeah, well, he loves his kids. I love my kids. I'm just showing you the total confusion and wickedness that we have allowed amongst our people, to the point where anybody that we feel agree with us on any point, we think are down with us. Okay. So, Gaja, where you want to go now? Now, you want to talk about some of this news, or what you want to do?
Yes. Yes. Nice as well. We are on YouTube stream, so let's go. You know, I feel like I'm on the streets right now. Let's do it, brother Shapat. Where you at?
All right, Shapat. Before you go there, real quick, I want to pull this out. We were talking about years ago, like in 2008 and 2009, how we were telling people they were coming up with this bogus swine flu campaign claiming that it was going to be a pandemic that never happened, right? All these flus, there is no pandemic. It would be crazy to get these vaccines, they kill a vaccine with all types of metals in it that are destroying our immune system and are causing serious illness amongst our people, no matter what the vaccine. You can slap a name, whatever name you want on. They're concoctions of poison and death and cancer. That's the bottom line. But on Natural News, it tells us, according to that swine flu, whatever the title they want to put that garbage, UK government admits swine flu vaccine causes brain damage and actually compensates 60 families for brain damage in their family with the swine flu vaccine. And yet, they didn't get the flu, though. But let me make this clear. They know that some people don't even... Listen, I would rather get the flu. I don't need no vaccine against the flu. If I run into somebody with a flu and I catch it, okay, I got the flu. A few days, I'll be fine. I don't need no darn vaccine for that.
But, you know, Ella, check the crazy thing about that article, right?
Yeah.
That was published in a UK newspaper, wasn't it?
Yes, United Kingdom.
Right, and nobody in the UK has responded to it. Like, you know, there's no uproar. There's no pushback. You follow me? Look at that. They come out and openly admit that the swine flu vaccine causing brain damage, right? And
yes.
Nobody said nothing. There's no protest. You with me? Nobody's saying, well, okay then, well, if this vaccine caused that, what about the other vaccines you've been giving us that we can get for free in Tesco? You with me?
Exactly.
Nobody's saying nothing. And this is the craziest thing when I look at the media sometimes, is that some of the things are put right there in the open. But
yeah.
Nobody...
They're not hiding anything.
Exactly.
Just like the march, is there another test for the government to see exactly where people are at?
Yeah. Put it right out there, see where you at, and see that there's no public outcry against this war, against this continual war, against this serious destruction that the world government of Satan is imposing on citizens. There's no public outcry. Because why? Because people, even if they wanted to outcry, they wouldn't know the first place to start. They wouldn't know, okay, what do I do? I disagree with this, but where do I go? What do I do? What do I say? Who can I talk to? Because the people are so divided.
Mm-hmm.
They're so divided. There's no public outcry. And the public outcry will only begin when our people come together and realize that they were born into a war.
Mm-hmm.
And first and foremost, deny anything the government is forcing on them together. You don't have to show brute force or some physical force against anyone. No, your best outcry is not to participate in it. Come together and say no.
Mm-hmm.
We're not doing it, and then deal with what comes from that. That'll let you know exactly what we're dealing with now. No to vaccine. No to homosexuality. No to pedophilia. No to school institutions teaching us to be institutionalized, preparing us for prison. No to the prison system of the drug gang. No. We're not participating. If you want to engage us face to face. Don't engage us through these stealth. No to vaccine. No to your prenatal killer, stealth killer pills you're giving our babies before they're born, and our women's ignorance and trusting the satanic pediatrician. Say no. That's the best. No one is saying go up to the arms against government and all that. They want you to do that. That's what they're trying to instigate. What we're saying is be informed and come together and say no to it. And then you can face the war right on. Then they'll have to engage you, and you will see exactly what you're dealing with. But we are participant
in this mess. We are participating in our own demise. That's what makes it bad, the fact that we participate in it. Some through ignorance, and some are doing it willingly. Like, who would support Rihanna and her satanic operation? Who would support, how is Jay-Z a billionaire? Who would support him in his satanic mess? Who would support these people who are destroying our people? So we know what's going on, but the sad thing about it is that we are participating with it. We won't say no to it. That's the bad thing about it. That's what's worse. And that's why people are not standing up. That's why people can't gather together, because a lot of us want this. The Bible tells us, man, that we trust in oppression and stay thereon. Say no to it, and then the enemy is going to have to face you and say, listen, we're really trying to kill you because you're the children of Israel, okay? We tried the other way. We tried to allow you to just die off and kill yourselves. But because you're not engaged in that, let me introduce myself. Let me come without stealth anymore. The reason that they come in with stealth, brothers and sisters, is because it works. They come in total ambiguity and in the darkness because it works. See, they couldn't come like that in 70 AD when we were in Israel, because we all knew we were Israel. We knew we were a people. They had to come with the armies. They had to come with force against us. They couldn't wait on us destroying ourselves, because we were a knowledgeable people. We were a people with culture and understanding in Israel when we were Israelites before the fall of 70 AD. They couldn't come with stuff. They couldn't convince a woman to abort their own child. They couldn't convince homosexualities to demoralize and help with the eugenics program and lowering our numbers. Because according to the Bible, homosexuals got put to death who were out in the open. They couldn't come to us with these things. They couldn't come with pedophilia, because they couldn't come with homosexuality. They couldn't come with the drug game, because there were laws put in place to protect our people. They had to come as Romans with a Roman army to destroy us, because we were the children of God. We knew why they were destroying. Okay? We knew it. And because we are a participating party in our own destruction, they don't feel a need to confront us with the real reason why they have been destroying our people for years. Not because we are black, because we are the children of Israel with a promise unforeseen, with a promise that will soon come to fruition. If there's one drop of Israelite blood left in this earth upon the coming of Christ, that one drop of blood, that one person will receive all the promise and total rulership of this earth. They understand. That's the real reason for all this. And it's a shame that conversation is not on public platform. I don't care how many billions of people they gather together for whatever they want to talk about that week or that day. That conversation is never brought forth. That we are the children of God in peril, a people without a home, a people that have suffered a Holocaust beyond a Holocaust, a destruction behind a destruction. That's never discussed. Because why? That would point to the perpetrators that are in our land claiming to be us. That would say, if they got this as their Holocaust, which really means sacrifice, by sacrificing their own people, if they got that to a sacrifice, then what should we receive? They don't really want open conversation on Holocaust. Because they have actually gave us a blueprint on what one receives when you do have a Holocaust. You get a land, okay? They don't want that conversation. Because, therefore, with that conversation, the slave must be set free. The children of Israel must go back. And what happens when there's no more slaves? There's no more prison. What happens? So there's no more economy. The whole world falls. Okay? This earth, right now, all nations are celebrated and are constructed and built on slave labor. Without us, there is no world economy. So we need to bring the real conversation to the forefront. The real conversation, who are the children of Israel? Okay. Who are the children of God? And if the Jewish people gave us an example of what, quote unquote, someone can get, claiming to be a child of God after a Holocaust, what do we receive? Now, if you want to talk, even though we're not looking for anything from you, if you're going to talk, shouldn't that be the conversation? Because with that come what? A law. No more religion. Don't give us, we don't want no Christianity, we don't want no Islam, we don't want no Buddhism, we don't want Oprah. We don't want none of it, okay? Let's go to this Bible, and we're going to come back as a community and follow the laws of the Bible now. Period. The Bible and the laws in the Bible governs us. But we got a law. We don't even need to draft the Constitution. We have a law already. Right there, we didn't got rid of homosexuals, pedophiles, murderers, killers, adulterers, sinners, people that would totally destroy our way of life. It's automatically pointed out and moved to the side. See? Why? Because they would have, in order to participate, they would have to follow the law. If you do anything to any of our family, you will suffer the penalties of the law. That would be simple. Why say that law is done away with and we shouldn't follow that law, but yet you will follow the American law and be penalized for it, enslaved for it, even further punitively within their industrial prison complex. So, hey, like I told her, I know she felt a certain type of way and she thought that this was going, but I'm like, listen, when you have a voice to move and influence others, this is a platform you have been called into. Get ready. And guess what? That's why I don't mind when people bring out things and try to do things. Listen, I was called to do this. I know what scrutiny comes with doing this. You have to be prepared to do it. Okay? You got to prepare yourself and be ready. Because this is what comes with the public life, especially if you're representing something that's supposed to be for the embedment of our people. And we're not looking for the embedment of the world. We're not looking for that. We're not looking so that homosexuals and others can operate with us in a civil society. There's no such thing as a civil society with lawlessness. We're in a Betty sinners. Okay, we're not looking for numbers. So yes, Azariah, when you get an opportunity, let's talk to her. Let's get a representative of the Nation of Islam on, and so that they can let us know why the LGBT movement or the lesbians, perverts, and pedophiles and homosexuals are now being invited to have a voice amongst the Nation of Islam. I would love to hear that, you know, that talking point. These homosexuals haven't circumvented us enough. Trying to compare their perversion to what we've dealt with under the hands of the slave owner. Trying to compare what they're going to us. That's a slap in the face. Every time they talk about rights, they want to bring up black people. Okay, that's a travesty that they would use us for their own perversion. Some of they was born this way and all this other hot mess they talking about. Okay, one moment. Are you with me,
Hey,
are you with me, God?
Yeah, yes, I'm here. I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, one moment. The video okay. Worked. Okay. All right. So, what you got, what you got on the news real quick? And I want to thank brothers and sisters again. The Academy is going great.
It's going great. We have another class coming this coming Sunday. And for those who want to participate going forward, we're only 1 month in, but you'll get the four lessons and all the information from the four that you've missed. And we have a lot to go. We have 2 months to go.
Thinking about the world, looking at the nation. Suicide, all right. Genocide, homicide. Three words come to mind. Times are changing, yeah. No more rumors, there are wars going on. Twisted doctor, scientists making clones. Economy got some backs against the wall. People dying for no reason at all. People of God don't even read their Bibles. There's no faith, no trust in the word. But everybody seems to be quoting scripture. It's just another word they heard. Pastors leaving pulpits cause they're tired. It's all based on how we feel. I overheard two people speaking the other day. One said that God's not real, but I'm just one of them more people who's got a hold on. Sometimes I can't see, but I still believe he's taking care of me. Oh, I'm just one of them old people God's got a hold on. And I believe, yeah. So I'll choose to look on the brighter side in spite of all the negativity I'm surrounded by. No, it ain't perfect, but that's alright. Cause his hand is on me and it's keeping me alive. So many disappointments. So much I don't understand. So much I don't have answers for. That's what makes me trust you more. In a world that's always changing, everything's rearranging. But no matter what's going on, I'ma be standing, I'ma be holding on. Your truth, their truth, my truth. Your God, my God, our view. All I know is one thing nowadays, is we all need hope, we all need faith, and I'm just one of them old people who's got a hold on. Sometimes I can't see, but I still believe he's taking care of me. Yes, he is. Oh, I'm just one of them old people God's got a hold on. Don't you let go of me, Lord, please. I believe, yeah. Oh, I'm just one of them old people who's got a hold on. Sometimes I can't see, but I still believe he's taking care of me. Yes, he is. Oh, I'm just one of them old people. I believe.